Father God, you have called us, your people, out of the world. You've called us out of our unbelief and out of our bondage to sin, and you have called us into the kingdom of your beloved Son. Father, you have shown us grace. You have poured your mercy upon us. And so, Father, as we come to your word this morning, we are asking that you would teach us, that you would prepare us, that you would instruct us by your Holy Spirit, that you would give us wisdom and insight and understanding, that we might live obedient, joyful lives in this increasingly chaotic and confusing time. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, will you please stand for the reading of God's word? We stand to demonstrate publicly that these words are altogether unique and different. These are God's holy words. Daniel 10. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a word was revealed to Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar. And the word was true, and it was a great conflict. And he understood the word and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning for 3 weeks. I ate no delicacies, no meat or wine entered my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all for the full 3 weeks. On the 24th day of the first month, as I was standing on the bank of the great river that is the Tigris, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a man clothed in linen with a belt of fine gold from Euphaz around his waist. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and the sound of his words like the sound of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great trembling fell upon them, and they fled to hide themselves. So I was left alone and saw this great vision, and no strength was left in me. My radiant appearance was fearfully changed, and I retained no strength. Then I heard the sound of his words, and as I heard the sound of his words, I fell on my face in deep sleep with my face to the ground. And behold, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly loved, understand the words that I speak to you and stand upright, for now I have been sent to you. And when he had spoken this word to me, I stood up trembling. And then he said to me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words. The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days, but Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I was left there with the kings of Persia, and came to make you understand what is to happen to your people in the latter days, for the vision is for days yet to come. When he had spoken to me according to these words, I turned my face toward the ground and was mute. And behold, one in the likeness of the children of man touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spoke. I said to him who stood before me, O my Lord, by reason of the vision, pains have come upon me, and I retain no strength. How can my Lord's servant talk with my Lord? For now no strength remains in me, and no breath is left in me. Again, one having the appearance of a man touched me and strengthened me. And he said, O man greatly loved, fear not, peace be with you. Be strong and of good courage. And as he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me. Then he said, do you know why I have come to you? But now I will return to fight against the prince of Persia. And when I go out, behold, the prince of Greece will come. But I will tell you what is inscribed in the book of truth. There is none who contends by my side except Michael, your prince. This is God's word. You may be seated. Chapter 10 of Daniel is the beginning of the last vision that Daniel will see. So we are to take Daniel 10, 11, and 12 as one vision, and chapter 10 as the beginning of this vision. And one of the things that you may notice that is different about chapter 10, especially verses against chapter 7, 8, and 9, is that chapter 10 doesn't contain any details per se about future events, not in the way that the previous chapters have contained those things. Rather, what chapter 10 is it reveals the nature, not details, but the nature of future events. So with that in mind, we're going to explore three different things that we see in the text. They are our conflict, our enemy, and our hope. Our conflict, our enemy, and our hope. We'll begin by considering our conflict. Daniel is a book of conflict. We've called this a guide to Christian resistance. From the very beginning of this book, we're confronted with conflict. It was King Nebuchadnezzar who had invaded Jerusalem, who had destroyed the city, taken the temple, and then taken Daniel and his buddies away from their hometown. There was conflict. Then we had Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had conflict with Nebuchadnezzar as they were threatened with that fiery furnace. We had Daniel's conflict with the satraps and Darius, and Daniel was then thrown into the lion's den. Then we have seen these visions, these great visions of kingdoms and beasts and conflict. We saw Antiochus's great attack upon Israel, and as well as the future invading Roman armies that would destroy the temple. There's conflict everywhere throughout the book of Daniel. But you need to notice what is happening in chapter 10. In the opening verse, it says this, "In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a word was revealed to Daniel, who was named Belshazzar, and the word was true, and it was what? A great conflict, not just conflict, but a great conflict, something so great that Daniel is going to tremble, his body's going to fail, he's going to be face first on the ground with no breath left in his lungs. This is a great conflict indeed. We will dive into some of those details in a moment, but I just want to take a moment to observe conflict, the presence of conflict, the reality of conflict. Conflict between the world and the people of God is the norm. Let me say that again. Conflict between the world and the people of God is the norm. That may not be your personal norm, but that is the historical norm. Meaning that we should not be surprised or caught off guard when we see, hear of, or experience conflict. This goes back to the very beginning of the story. In Genesis chapter 3, we read of Adam and Eve's sin and the fall and the judgment that is pronounced upon them. And God himself speaks these words in Genesis 3:15. It says, "I will put enmity between you," that is the serpent, that is our enemy, the devil. "I will put enmity between you and the woman. Her offspring and you are going to be in conflict." There will be enmity. Now, there's so many things that we could unpack from that, just that particular verse about who are the offspring of Eve and who are the offspring of the serpent. But I just want you to notice God is announcing a story of what? Enmity. Everything moving forward from that point is conflict. It's enmity. In fact, the next thing that happens in Genesis 4 is murder. One brother kills his other brother. Enmity, conflict. And that conflict keeps working itself throughout the entire Bible. If you don't understand that the story of God and the story that the scriptures present us with is a story of enmity and conflict, then the Bible's not going to make much sense to you. In fact, if you don't understand that there is a massive conflict in a battle and a war being waged, if you don't understand that, you are going to end up with a hippie, feminist, pacifist, vegan Jesus who was a life coach but can't save you from anything. The Bible, friends, listen, it's about conflict. You go, why is there so many battles in the Bible? Because it's about conflict. Jesus himself taught us this. In John 15, he says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. So here's Jesus talking about the world, and he says that the world hated him. There are people acting as if we were just more like Jesus, then the world would love us. No, right? No, the world hated Jesus. That was Jesus' assessment of the situation. The world hated him. They hated him so much that they crucified him. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ is not some deviation from or an exception to the values and the beliefs of the world. Let me say that again. The crucifixion of Jesus Christ is not some deviation from or exception to the values and the beliefs of the world. Understand this. The crucifixion of Jesus was the most pure expression of what the world is all about. If you want to understand how the world relates to God, look at the crucifixion. That is the purest expression of it. So the world hated Christ. And that means if you're a follower of Jesus, if you belong to him, you trust in him, you are loyal to him, then the world is going to hate you because it hates him and he is in you. This is simple. You can't avoid it. This is the clear teaching of scriptures. You can't work your way around this reality. There's no special like Jedi tricks that you can pull that are going to make the world love you. Like, you're the exception to the world of what Jesus said. There's no third way out of this thing. Conflict between the church and the world is norm. Read the book of Acts. You notice how much conflict is in the book of Acts? Riots, jailings, beatings. Is that because the world loved the apostles? Because they loved Christ? Because they loved the church? It wasn't. It's because there's conflict. Conflict between the world and the people of God is the norm. One of the reasons that this is so, and I'll say this, understandably difficult for some of us to understand, is because we are living in a time between the times. Meaning things are changing right now. And some of us have a memory of how things used to be, and they're not that way anymore. And there's a whole spectrum. Some of you have more memories of the way things used to be. Some of you don't know a world without a smartphone. Okay? So understand there's a spectrum here, but things have totally changed. And there was a time, and some of you remember this, and some of you experienced this, there was a time in our country and in our community where Christian theology was not accepted by all, but Christian ethics were accepted by most, okay? So understand, there was a time where most people did not believe in the Trinity, okay? They did not believe in the deity of Christ. They did not believe in virgin birth. They did not believe in literal, physical, historical resurrection. They did not believe in the doctrine of justification by faith alone. They didn't believe those things. However, they did hold to predominantly Christian ethics. So they don't hold our faith, right? But they did embody and ascribe to a general Christian ethic. The consequence of that is that everybody basically knew, for the most part, what a man was. Everybody basically knew what a woman is. Everybody knew what marriage was and what marriage was not. Everybody knew that drag queen story hour was an unthinkably wicked thing. We all knew that mutilating children was morally and objectively evil. We all knew these things because there was a general understanding and acceptance of Christian ethics. But here's the thing. Those days are gone. Those days are gone. That is not the norm. This is not just happening somewhere else. It's not just happening in some other corner of the country. It's things that are happening around us. They're happening in our community. It's happening right now. And what that means is that you have to understand that our experience as Christians and our experience as followers of Christ, our experience as the church is going to be different than it was 10 years ago. Our faith is not different. Our God is not different. But our experience in this world is very different. There will be more conflict. There will be more contention because we don't have a shared ethic. What Daniel was seeing in chapter 10 is a great conflict. And what we are increasingly seeing is a great conflict. That's what it is, a conflict. This leads us to our enemy. We've seen lots of different enemies throughout the book of Daniel. We've seen in chapter 2 the image that Nebuchadnezzar had in his dream of that four-tiered figure, each representing four kingdoms. There was a rock that was chucked at that figure. That rock destroyed the figure, and it turned into a mountain that filled the whole earth. That, of course, was Christ. Then we have seen in chapter 8, maybe you remember the ram and that flying horned goat. Remember the goat that was moving swiftly over the land, like levitating over the ground? And we talked about the 4-H competition acid trip thing that was happening. And we had the Medes and the Persians and Greece and the great leader from Greece and this massive conflict. All this stuff is happening. But notice where we are in chapter 10. We don't see that in chapter 10. What we do see is something mysterious, overwhelming, nauseating, alarming, confusing, something that causes Daniel to be undone. In verse 5, there was a man dressed in fine linen with words like a multitude. In verse 10, a hand touches Daniel and an angel speaks to him. In verse 13, we're introduced to the prince of Persia. In verse 13, we're also introduced to Michael, who is the prince of Daniel's people. There's one in the likeness of man who speaks to Daniel. And with all of these different things, these figures, there's questions. And the questions are, who are these people? Who are these figures? The one that stands out most to us is the man who is clothed in linen with a gold belt and a body like beryl with a face shining like lightning, legs and arms that gleam like burnished bronze. That figure that Daniel sees, it does sound quite familiar to what John sees in the first chapter of Revelation. It says, and in the midst of the lampstands, one like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and with a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white, like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice was like the roar of many waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. And when I saw him, just like Daniel, I fell at his feet as though dead. John is seeing the glorified Christ. And they're not fist bumping, buddy, buddy, right? John is undone. He's on the ground. He's overwhelmed by it. There's some who make a good case that maybe what Daniel is seeing here, at least that first figure, is Christ. But there's also problems with that understanding. The text isn't totally clear. But I want you to notice that in a text like this, there's a temptation to be concerned with the wrong things. We want to know who each one of these people are. The reality is we don't know, and it's not made overwhelmingly clear in the text. But there are things that are clear in the text, and we have to emphasize the clear things. My buddy Joe Holland, who is a professor at a seminary, he was sending me a message texting me, and he said this: nothing good comes from being overly specific about your eschatological views. And I think he's probably generally right. The more specific we get, the weirder we get, okay? Apocalyptic literature by nature is first concerned with impressions. It's meant to make you feel something. You're supposed to have a response to what you're reading on the scripture. So what is most important may not be who exactly all these figures are, but what this all means for us. So what's obvious is that these are not human beings that Daniel is seeing. That's not what's happening in this text. What we are seeing and what Daniel is seeing is a glimpse behind the curtain, if you will. The veil is being pulled back, right? Daniel has seen kings. He's seen kingdoms. He's seen Babylon, the Medes, the Medes, the Persians, Greece, and Rome. He's seen all of this, but now he's seen something behind it all. He is seeing what his eyes and our eyes do not naturally see. That is this. There is a reality behind reality. There is a reality behind reality. There is a reality behind the events of history, behind the rising and the falling of these kingdoms and these kings, behind the conflict that Daniel has personally experienced, and behind the conflict that he has seen in these visions. Behind it all, there are great, powerful, dark spiritual realities. Look again at verses 12, 13, and 20. Then he said to me, "Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words." So Daniel is praying to God, and the effect of that is one of God's servants is sent. Okay? Verse 13, "The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. This is a three-week battle between this angel and this other dark angel. But Michael, another angel, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I was left there with the kings of Persia." And then in verse 20, "But now I will return to fight against the prince of Persia. And when I go out, behold, the prince of Greece will come." So there's all of these things happening that Daniel cannot see with his eyes, and he cannot know except that it's revealed to him by God, which is what's happening in chapter 10. Daniel had been in prayer. He's praying for his people. He's praying for the city. He's praying for the temple. And now he sees what's going on. There are great, great, great spiritual battles going on behind the scene. Michael is one of the chief princes. Apparently, we're supposed to know what that means, right? He's one of the chief princes. He also is the prince of either Israel or Daniel, or probably both. And he came to the aid of whoever is speaking to Daniel because that angel was caught up in this 21-day battle, again, that came as a result of Daniel's prayer. So one of the things that seems to be happening in this text is that there are dark spiritual forces that are assigned to kings and kingdoms or to regions. And Daniel is seeing that. One of the things that's interesting to note is when Jesus starts his public ministry, he encounters demonic stuff everywhere. That's a reality. We have these spiritual forces. We have these spiritual battles. There are good angels. There are evil angels. There are battles that are taking place. What does that mean for Daniel? What does it mean for us as we are studying this chapter? Well, it means this. Just as Daniel has seen the developments of history from the human side, kings and kingdoms and battles and people being replaced, right? There's another reality to all of this that Daniel is also going to see. Behind all of the developments of history, behind the rising and falling of kings and kingdoms, behind all of it, behind the conflict that Daniel himself has experienced and will experience, behind the conflict that Daniel's people will experience in the near future, and behind all of the conflict between God's people and the church, behind it all, there are dark, terrifying spiritual realities. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians 6 says this, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." Conflict. Paul says, you've got a conflict, church. There is conflict. But that conflict is not with Nero, per se. It's not with Domitian. Rather, it's not flesh and blood. Rather, it is against the rulers, against authorities, against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Church, you're in a conflict, and it is demonic. Now, I want to ask this question, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful. I want you to think about this, okay? Do you think that Paul is telling the truth here? If somebody stood before you and said, oh, the church is engaged in this dark spiritual force, this dark spiritual battle against demons, part of you is tempted to write that off and say, that person's a little crazy, right? Do you think Paul's telling the truth? This isn't Benny Hinn, guys. This isn't some sweaty TV preacher with a private jet. This is the Apostle Paul saying, church, wake up. You're engaged in a battle against very powerful, dark, demonic, spiritual forces. Do you believe him? Do you live like that's true? Ian DeGweed, in his commentary, he said this, the satanic forces opposed to the church continue to use the powers and institutions of this world in their struggle against God's people. Throughout history, Satan's enmity against the church will be vented time and time again. Here's his point, that demonic forces do work through institutions. They work through kingdoms. They work through governments to do the bidding of their leader, of Satan. And they don't always work at the same level. Sometimes it's more intense. Sometimes it's less intense, but the battle is never over. There are waves that come and go. Abraham Kuyper, he said, if once the curtain were pulled back and the spiritual world behind it came to view, it would expose to our spiritual vision a struggle so intense, so convulsive, sweeping everything within its range, that the fiercest battle ever fought on earth would seem by comparison a mere game. We need to understand that behind history lies a great, dark, spiritual battle. From the fall in the Garden of Eden, from that point forward, there has been conflict. Conflict between the serpent and conflict between the people of God. And we are witnesses of that conflict. What we are seeing is the heat being dialed up in that conflict in our day. There are demonic influences and demonic powers behind the ideologies that are so pervasive in our culture today. Behind things like abortion, behind things like drag queen story hour, which is now in Port Orchard, by the way. Behind things like the sexual revolution, behind the totalitarian drift and wickedness of our own government, behind things that are going on between Russia and the Ukraine and China, behind all of that, there are powerful, dark, spiritual forces. Now, don't be deceived into thinking that you've got demonic forces behind this country, and they go to war with this country, and there's no dark demonic forces behind this country. That's not how it works. Satan's on both sides, because he wants death. And he wants human suffering. The goal of demonic influence is always the destruction of human life because human beings are made in the image of God. Every human being is a reminder to Satan that God is God and he is not. As you think about this, you might find yourself feeling like Daniel, on the ground, face down, feeling ill, no breath in your lungs. There is good news. This leads us to our hope. There are four things, I think, in this text that can give us great hope, meaning they can be encouraging to us, and they're encouraging to us regardless of how dark or how difficult things may get. Look at verses 12 and 19. It says, "Then he said to me, 'Fear not, Daniel. From the first day that you set your heart to understand and humbled yourself before your God, your words have been heard, and I have come because of your words.' And he said, 'O man greatly loved, fear not. Peace be with you. Be strong and of good courage.'" The four things are this. First, God hears our prayers. When we pray, God listens, God moves, God deploys, God answers. When Daniel enters into this time of prayer, he tells us this was for 21 days. Then a few verses later, we hear of this demonic, this angelic battle that's going on between good angels and dark angels. How long did that battle go on for? 21 days. You think that's coincidence? Do you know that when you pray, God unleashes things, and when we pray, there's demonic opposition to that? Things are happening that we cannot see. Daniel is praying for 21 years, for 21 days, and someone is sent to help Daniel, and he's caught up, and someone else has to come and help this angel. 21 days. Friends, God hears our prayers. He hears our prayers. He listens. He moves. He answers our prayers. Our prayers matter. Our prayers matter. That's why 2 weeks ago we met across the street from Planned Parenthood to pray. Prayer is the weapon that God has given to his people. It's a really good weapon. We don't fight against flesh and blood. That's not the nature of the battle. It's against forces, and therefore we must use spiritual weapons. Prayer is our spiritual weapon. And when we pray, church, God hears our prayers. The fact that God has not moved immediately, the fact that God has not answered you immediately does not mean that God is not hearing your prayers or that God is not moving. Friends, know this, God hears our prayers. Second, we are greatly loved. Daniel is reminded that he is dearly loved. Do you think Daniel felt loved when Nebuchadnezzar invaded Jerusalem and destroyed the city? Did Daniel just feel loved? Do you think that Daniel felt loved at the end of his life after spending decades in Babylon when he wanted to be in Jerusalem? Did he feel loved? When Darius, according to the edict, sent Daniel to the lion's den, do you think that Daniel felt loved? But he was loved. He was dearly loved. You can never bank God's love on your circumstances. You can never measure God's love based on your current situation. God's love is far deeper than that. The scriptures tell us that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. How do you know that God loves you? Christ died for your sins. That's how you know that he loves you. Church, do you know that God loves you this morning? Do you believe it? Do you trust in it? Are you clinging to it? He sent his son to die for you. He sent his son to die in our place for our sins. Our sins deserve death. But Christ was crucified in our place for our sins so that we might not receive and be subject to God's judgment or the condemnation for our sins, but that rather we would have eternal life. That is a life that cannot be taken from you. That is a life that no king, no governor, no president, no government, no sickness can take from you. It will never be destroyed or diminished. Do you know that love? Do you know the love of God this morning? Be encouraged, church, and know that you are loved by God. Third, Daniel is told to fear not and peace be with you. Whenever the Bible tells you fear not, it means you're in a not great situation, right? If you are next to the pool, in a chair, sipping a mimosa, whatever you want, no one ever has to come up to you and say, hey, fear not, right? You're like, I'm not afraid of anything. We're told to fear not because we find ourselves in fearful situations. How is it that Daniel could see all these crazy things going on behind the scenes? Everything that was coming in history, the rising and falling of these kingdoms, the judgment that's coming, the dark spiritual realities at work. How in the world could Daniel see all of that with his eyes and have peace and not be afraid? How could he do that? 1 John chapter 4 tells us, for he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Understand this, church. The dark spiritual forces and realities that we face in this world are greater than us. They are greater than you. You are no match for the enemy. You are no match for these demonic forces. Martin Luther, in his song, right, in his famous hymn, says this, did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be what? You know what he's saying? He says, if this is on your strength, you're going to tap out so fast. If this is you, you're going to lose. You're going to get knocked out in like 3 seconds. You're going to be destroyed if you trust in your own strength, because you and your own strength are no match for the enemy. The enemy will beat you every single time. If it is you or me versus the world, if it's you and me versus evil spirits, if it's you and me versus the devil himself, we are in serious trouble. He will win every time. But it's not you versus the world, church. It's he who is in you versus the world. See, we are not greater than the world, but the one who lives in us is far greater than the world. It is the Spirit of God who is dwelling in you who is greater than our enemies. He who is in you is greater than the world. Nowhere is this clearer than in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? In the crucifixion of Jesus, the world delivers its best shot on Jesus. It delivers its most deadly weapon. It is unleashed on Christ in the crucifixion. And what happens to Christ? He takes a 3-day nap and wakes up, right? And that's the best shot that the world had at him. And it did nothing. Colossians 2 says this, he disarmed the rulers. That is, that God the Father disarmed the rulers and the authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in Christ, his Son, in him. The rulers and the authorities have been disarmed. Not only have they been disarmed in a very polite and respectful way, but they've been put to open shame. Open shame. God has embarrassed the world with the resurrection of his Son, and he has conquered the darkness. He has conquered our enemy. Therefore, friends, we don't need to be afraid, and therefore we can have peace. Lastly, Daniel is told to be strong and courageous. We must be strong and courageous, church. You know what that means? It means be joyful in your obedience to God and be joyful in your defiance to the world. This has been modeled throughout the book of Daniel. When Daniel gets captured, right? He is defiant. He's joyfully defiant. As he refuses the steak and the wine from the king, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were strong and courageous when Nebuchadnezzar threatened them with the flames of the furnace. Daniel was strong and courageous when Darius sealed him in the pit full of hungry lions. Strong and courageous. Christ was strong and courageous when they nailed him to the cross. So church, be strong. Be courageous. Be of good cheer, knowing that the God who delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the God who delivered Daniel, and the God who delivered Christ himself from the grave, that God is our God. Amen? And he too will deliver us. Let's pray. Lord, just as Daniel was overwhelmed by what he saw, so we too feel overwhelmed by the things that we see and the knowledge of dark spiritual forces and realities, the battles that take place around us each day. And yet, God, you have told us to not be afraid, but to be courageous and to be of good cheer. So, Lord, would you fill us with a defiant joy, a peace that the world cannot understand, a resolve to follow you regardless of the cost. And Lord, we ask that you would continue to hear our prayers, prayers for healing, prayers for salvation, prayers for transformation in our community, in our country, and in the world. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.